a lung disease of some sort, and looks like she may only live a couple days. So if you would remember to pray for her, that would be a blessing. Also, David Brindle's aunt is supposed to be having, I think, surgery. So if you would keep that in mind. Also, Patty Betchen, I think is how you say that. Cher's sister's mother-in-law, did I get that right? Okay. Has pancreatic cancer and was in remission, and they've found some more lesions on her liver now, and it's not looking good, so they ask us to request prayer for that. So if you think to pray for that, that'd be a blessing for them. So keep some of these things in mind, many other needs that I won't take time to mention tonight. We do have a some people going for some very important tests in the morning. We'd like to ask you to pray for those things. Also, Brother Vaughn, right after church tonight, we'd like to have a meeting with all the security team in the men's choir room. So if you're part of the security team, don't forget about that. And finally, the teens, you'll be having a get-together on New Year's Eve up here at 6 o'clock. Make sure you bring $10, and I'm sure you'll have a great time. Amen. I'll be at home, but I'm sure y'all have a great time. Praise the Lord. Amen.
Well, appreciate all that love for the teens there, Brother Matt. Let's go ahead and have the ushers come, if you would. Ushers, you make your way up. I want you to be praying tonight for Brother Brian Wilson as he is preaching over at Brother Bruce's church, Harvest Time Baptist Church. And then also, Brother Shelby Mace, who normally sits right over here and is just in from Bible College. He is preaching also tonight off down in Hildebrand somewhere. So I want you to be praying for Brother Brian and Brother Shelby that the Lord would use those guys while they're there. And then, of course, pray for these fellows that are about to preach. These young men sitting on the front row, the nervous looking crowd sitting right over in here behind the ushers. You pray for them. The Lord would use them tonight in a special way as well. All right, let's pray. Father, we thank you for all you do for us. We thank you, Lord, that you do hear and answer our prayers. As we talked about this morning, we can look back over this year and see evidences and situations where you specifically heard us and answered us and helped us. And we praise you for that. We want to look back thankfully, Lord, and give you some praise for it. And we ask you to bless now again these needs that were mentioned. Help the ones Brother Matt mentioned tonight. We pray that you'd be with those folks that are having physical problems and awaiting test results, and ones that are still battling sicknesses that they've had now for some time. We pray you bless them. I think Miss Parker, who's still taking treatments. I think Brother Boyce, who's still in the middle of figuring all of his cancer situation out. Help Brother Parker, who was just in the hospital a week or so ago. We pray that you'd be with all these different ones, Lord. Help Miss Jill. She continues to battle hers. Brother Chris and Miss Dorothy Yarborough as they struggle. Lord, different ones and anybody that I've forgotten. We pray that you'd bless them. And Lord, help us now tonight. Be with the offering. Be with the preaching and the singing that is to come. We'll praise you for it in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, kids, you go ahead as well. We'll get the change tonight. Never mind, I don't see a bucket. All right, kids, you can bring it and put it in this green thing right here. Praise God. Somebody took the buckets. Everybody got change in you. Over here, we got change over here. Trefton, help them folks right there. Right down that side. Go down that side. There we go. Got some in the back too, Trefton. Look back there. Right back here, Miss Kiva's got some money. She's loaded too. That just ain't no telling how much she's holding. Praise God. Probably gold coins. Somebody get that. Hold your hand up, Miss Kiva. Here she. Oh, wait. She's giving it to her. You go. She's got it, Micah. Never mind. Bring what you got, children. I see it. Brother Glenn. Bad legs getting excited over here. Praise God. Amen. All right. I mentioned this morning, some of you were here, maybe some of you weren't. Brother Glenn and Miss Cheryl LePage have, in the last few months, surrendered, as the Lord has been dealing with them, to go to his home country as missionaries. And you know, some of you know they visited there. How long ago was it? 2 years you visited there? 3 years ago they visited, and we prayed and was hoping he'd be able to lead his mom to the Lord in particular. She did not get saved while he was there, and they have prayed for some time that you know, the Lord would send a preacher there, and finally they've just decided that they'll go and be that preacher. So we praise the Lord for their family. And they've already ministered in some churches there when they've been back, done some singing. He's done some speaking there, and the kids have quoted some verses, I think, and stuff. And so we're excited about that, and he's going to come and just, you know, just take a few minutes and tell y'all kind of what the Lord's doing in their heart and what the next step is between now and when they go. So you listen, Brother Glenn.
Well, really, he told me I was the first of the young preachers to preach tonight, so... No, I know they have nerves of steel, but I'm nervous, I'm eager, and I'm scared stiff. And if I was 18 or 20 years old and I felt like that, there was something fixing to be done, I'll tell you that. But now add to that, I'm available, and God has been dealing with me for over a year, I think, about this, and going home. And at our last mission conference, he really dealt with me. And at the end of the mission conference, to make a long story short, I said to my wife, I need to talk to you and the family about a thing or two. And I said, Lord's been working on my heart about teaching and preaching. And I said, I can't get it out of my mind, out of my heart. I said, I feel like we need to go back to Guernsey and preach and teach and plant a church. And she says, I knew it, she said. And I'm thinking, man, when she knew it already, you know. So, like I said, it's all brand new to us. We're brand new. I'm not sure yet about deputation. I think we're going on deputation. And we've had three or four churches offer us to go preach and teach and visit with them anyway. Brother Chad's church in Texas, they offered us to go down there. And I preached for the first time last week, and that was kind of scary. But can I preach like Tony Shirley? No, he preaches his style. Am I equipped to preach like Tony Shirley? I got a lot of learning to do, but I got the tools. Amen. I know Jesus, and I know Jesus in Genesis, and I know Jesus in Revelation, and I can tell him what he did for me. If it wasn't for God's grace, I'd be on that island. I would be a drunken bum by now. In fact, that's how I left there, pretty much. But I thank him for his grace and his mercy, and for saving me and my family, and for sending us to New Manor. He sent me here, and I wondered why I was sitting down there for so long. But he was teaching me about churches. He's been teaching us, and the new church we're in, about how the church works, how a church serves, about soul winning, and about the love of God's people. You know, we have to. I can't go over them and bash them over the head with the authorized version like I'd like to do, but he's been humbling me over a while. But he's shown me this year, you know, that you need to give him the love of Jesus. And just like we felt here, Pastor Shirley's been a blessing in my life. I love that man. He's, every time I talk to him or ask him a question, he said, I'm going to pray for you. I'm going to pray for your family. And he prayed for my mother out there. That was 3-4 years ago when we were going. He's been praying for us. He prayed for our adoption. He all prayed for us, and we thank you for that. Kids got adopted. Kids got saved. They got fed here. They got filled to the top here with Jesus, Brother Dwayne. And we filled them up at home with Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. How much can the kids take of Jesus? Well, you bring them in manna, they're going to get overloaded with Jesus. There's no room for anything else. So you keep the good work up, Brother Charlie. Don't let a child, don't leave a child to himself, okay? Like you preached that time. And we appreciate New Manor and all the prayers you've given us. And we'd ask that you pray for those people out there. They need the Lord. And we're Lord willing, we're going to plant a church out there, a Baptist church. But and we're going to say some more about it later, I think, later dates. But thank you very much, yes. New Manor. Appreciate
Amen.
It.
Amen, brother. Well, at least we sound alike. And we're like twins. Amen. Praise the Lord. I wish I had his hair and his voice, to be honest with you. I mean, I'm not coveting or anything, except I am. But I'm not preaching tonight, so it's okay if I'm completely backslid in my heart right now. Praise God. We're excited for them, very excited. They're supposed to, are you still planning to do the visit this year like you were, even if you're not going over in time? So they're going in like June or something like that. All right. So, amen. So they're taking a trip this year regardless of whether it's the stay in time or coming back to do deputation. But it'd be good to see his family, some of them, get saved on this trip. Wouldn't that be good? That'd pretty much stir you up to come back for deputation, wouldn't you say? And if mama got saved while you was over there visiting, then you could come back and say, now I need to go back and win the rest of them. So be praying about that. And we do praise the Lord. We've seen some answered prayers in their lives, and we thank the Lord for that. Let's have the choir come sing just a little bit, and then we'll let the preacher boys loose here in a minute. I see one of the preacher boys say, praise God. He still don't want it to start. Amen. He's wanting it to get on during the singing and no preaching tonight. Amen. If you're visiting with us, I don't normally lead the congregational singing or the choir. It's not one of those churches where the guy does everything, okay? Just in case you're visiting right back in here and somewhere over there. Our song director is in Florida, and our choir director's got the flu or something, they said. I don't know exactly what he's... Stomach bug? Well, he can keep it. How many of you say amen? Stay home if you got stomach bug. And then the guy that backs both of them up, he's in Michigan. And Brother Brian that backed the choir director up this morning, he's preaching off tonight. So I don't mind to do it. I just wanted to say that. All right? Is that okay?
All right. Now y'all sing to it. Okay? Number five.
There's the sound of the bells ringing, ringing joy across the way. Jesus, 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 Jesus
coming down and shake hands with somebody, and then we'll start the preaching here in just a minute. Amen. Good singing. Be seated. I believe Brother Glenn and Miss Cher do have prayer cards with them. If you want to get some of those, and I know some of you, you know, pray for them already, but it'll help you to pray specifically about this ministry that the Lord has laid on their hearts. And so tonight, if you just came in, you don't know what's going on, it being the last Sunday night of the year. We did this last year. And how many of you remember what I did with the staff after the Preacher Boys preached last year? How many of y'all remember that? How many of y'all are hoping I do that again tonight? Notice none of the staff hands went up. And fellas, I'm not doing that tonight. You're off the hook. And they'll amen a lot louder now. And if you were not here, I just put a bunch of crazy items in a bag and called all the staff up here after the preacher boys finished. And I'd draw their name and I'd draw something out of the bag and they had to preach on whatever was in there. And it ended up being, all except for Brother Charlie, it was pretty spiritual. And but everybody's got their part to play, right, Brother Charlie? And he, if y'all remember, he said, "Mary, did you know?" and went crazy on every Christmas song he could think of. Might near blasphemed, and it was a great night. It was had by all. But we're not doing that tonight, praise the Lord. We're just going to have the preacher boys preach. And so what we're going to do is I'm going to draw a name, and then we'll sing maybe one verse of "Oh, How I Love Jesus," and give that boy a chance to get ready. And then right before he preaches, he'll draw the name of the next one. So each one will have about 3 to 5 minutes to get ready, depending on how long his buddy preaches before him. So the first preacher for the evening will be Brother Michael Garner. Brother Jason. Oh. It'll be over with. Yeah, you can look at it one of two ways. So Brother Jason's going to time them. He's their youth pastor, and he's done this for them before, and then he'll give them some kind of... I said, "Do you got a buzzer or a bell?" Sometimes we had a bell. He said, "I don't have a bell." I said, I bet somebody's got a taser. How many of you for that? If they go past their five, so he can give them a 1 minute warning. You got 1 minute. If they don't stop, then we tase them. I think that'd be excitement right there. That'd be wonderful. So I'm glad they didn't do that to us when we were the preacher boys. Praise God. Let's sing a little bit of "Oh, How I Love Jesus." We'll sing the chorus. Then we'll sing that first verse. There is a name. And then we'll sing the chorus again. And then we'll have Brother Michael Garner come and preach. Arvin, I'm going to turn on just the red one. I told them if they needed to move around, they can grab the red mic there. And so hopefully they'll remember that. Let's sing a little bit of it from your heart now. Oh, how I love Jesus. Sing it. Oh, how I love Jesus. Mean it now. How I love Jesus. Because he first loved me. There is a name, and there is a name I love to sing its worth. Love to sing it worth. It sounds like music in my ear. The sweetest name. Sing your harmony parts now. Sing it out unto the Lord. Oh, how I love Jesus. Come on, Brother Michael, make your way up here. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Because he first loved me. Because he first loved me. You You want us to sing some more? You want us to keep singing? Keep singing. All right, step up here. You got to draw the name of the next candidate, if you will. So you do that. I'm giving them a little extra help of Holy Ghost by letting them put their names in this Kentucky Wildcat Cup. I'll set that there to help them. Who'd you get? Samuel Oakes will be next. All right, Brother Samuel, you've got a few minutes to be ready. This is Brother Michael. Most of you know Brother Jason's son. How old are you, Brother Michael? 14 years old. He's going to preach to you. You listen.
Come on.
Preach it, my friend.
Good evening.
Good evening.
If you have your Bibles, please turn to 1 Timothy 4, verse 12. I'm just going to go ahead and start reading it. It says, "Let no man despise thy youth, but be thou an example of the believers in word and conversation, in charity and spirit and in faith and purity." I'm just going to preach for a minute on to be thou an example. This verse is telling us we need to be an example for the Lord. We need to show the world what Jesus is like and what he wants us to be like. It says we need to be examples of believers in word and conversation, in charity and spirit and faith and in purity. What we don't need to do is be impure and say you're a Christian and then do all the worldly things, because people will see that and they're going to be like, well, he's a Christian, why can't I do that too? So we can't do that. We need to, I'm going to say a couple things we need to be pure to, who we need to be pure to. We need to be pure to our family members. Parents, you need to be pure to your children. I'm not a parent, so I'm not there yet. But parents to your children. Also, we need to do it to our family members, like our aunts, uncles, great uncles, great aunts, great great aunts, so on and so forth. We need to be examples to them, because I have people in my family that aren't saved and aren't living for the Lord, and we need to be examples to them. We also need to be examples to people we know, people at your work. There's also people there that aren't saved or living for the Lord, and we need to be examples to them too. And also we need to, you know, to your friends. Adults have friends too, and we need to be examples to them also. And also, but most importantly, we need to be examples to the world. We need to be looked at by the world, and people look at us like they look different. They look, we need to look like a Christian. We need to be examples for them. And I'm pretty much done, but be examples for the Lord.
Amen, Michael. Amen.
Amen. That's exactly right. In purity, in spirit, in faith, in charity. Charity, that active love of God. A great verse right there for all of us. One of the first verses I ever memorized, that verse right there, Brother Michael. That's good preaching. I believe Brother Samuel was next. Come on, Brother Samuel. He's going to draw the name of the next candidate, and then he'll preach to us. How old are you, Brother Samuel?
16.
What number are you in that list of children in your house? Do you know?
33.
Oh, 33. You've been holding out on us, sister. He just said that because he don't know, does he? Bless his heart. He's so nervous, that's the first thing came to his mind.
It has a three in it.
It has a three in it. All right. All right, Christopher Pearson will be next. Brother Samuel's drawing his name. Brother Samuel Oakes, did you tell me how old you were? If you did, I forgot already. 16 years old. He's going to come preach to you.
Come on, Sam.
Take your time to preach.
Howdy there. If you would turn to the Bibles to the book of 2 Timothy, chapter number 4. Got a lot of stuff here, and I don't think I can read it all in 5 minutes. So when he's got the taser behind me, just tell me. All right.
Yeah.
And everything?
You we
think?
Got it.
You got it?
We're ready.
I don't want to be tased.
You don't want to be tased.
Okay, I'll start in verse 16 here. It says, "At my first answer, no man stood with me, but all men forsook me. I pray God that it may not be led to their charge. Notwithstanding, the Lord stood with me and strengthened me, that by me the preaching might be fully known, and that all the Gentiles might hear. And I was delivered out of the mouth of the lion, and the Lord shall deliver me from every evil work, and will preserve me unto his heavenly kingdom. And whom be the glory forever and ever. Amen. Well, right here, I reckon, when I was studying this, I found a bunch of different people, and I'm seeing three different kinds of things here. We always see in this, in Daniel chapter 3:6, is when Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego is going to get thrown into the fire. And, in the verse 6, it's talking about, verse 15, the king Nebuchadnezzar, he was doubting, for it said, who is that God that shall deliver you? But in verse 17, I think, I got to find it here. Somewhere around here. It says in verse 17 that it's verse 17. It says, if it be so, our God whom we serve is able to deliver us from the burning fiery furnace, and he will deliver us out of thine hand, O King. When I see in these two stories, you always see the people who doubts the Christians in their in the world. Nebuchadnezzar doubted that God wouldn't be able to deliver Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego out of the fire. But you always see the devoted Christian in these stories. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, even though they knew that they was about to die right there, and it was on their life, they still stood for God. And they still was not willing to bow to that idol. But always, you always see at the end, in verse 25, and it says, he answered and said, lo, I see four men loose walking in the midst of the fire, and they have no hurt, and the form of the fourth man is like the Son of God. And then Nebuchadnezzar came near to the mouth of the burning fiery furnace and spoke and said, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, ye servants of the Most High God, come forth and come hither. And Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego came forth in the midst of the fire. At the end, I've always saw in these stories, and I have several people. You got Paul here, is 2 Timothy, Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. You see all the same things that happens. You always see the doubt in the world who doubts that the Lord can help you and get you through these hard times of your life. But then you always see the devoted Christian. He's devoted to standing, and he won't do anything that goes against the Lord. Then always at the end, you will see the delivering God. He always delivers you, even in these hard times of this world. And in the hard times of this world here, he will deliver you from every evil work, and he won't let you stand in. I've got to read one more verse here, and I'll go on down, I reckon. In Luke 8:23-24, it says, but as they sailed, he fell asleep. And this is talking about Jesus. They in the boat, and they just got in, and they start sailing on the lake. So it says, but as they sailed, he fell asleep, and there came a storm of wind on the lake. And there, what?
1 minute.
1 minute. Okay. I lost my place. And there came a storm of wind on the lake, and there were filled with water, and were in jeopardy. And they came to him and awoke him, saying, Master, Master, we perish. Then he arose and rebuked wind and raging of the water, and they ceased, and there was a calm. The Lord, this was some of the probably worst storm the disciples has ever seen. But just in time, the Lord came by and he calmed the storm. Yeah. So if you're going through a storm right now and a hard time, don't ever lose hope in the Lord, because he will always come just in time.
Good Amen. Amen. Good job.
Amen. Christopher, just like Brother LePage speaks so eloquently, and then I speak like I speak, Brother Michael said, good evening. Brother Samuel said, howdy. Hey, I'm thankful. Praise God, he can use us all. Amen. Brother Christopher, he's so excited to be here. Aren't you, Christopher?
Roman Greer.
Hey, I'll read the name, sir. Take a minute off his time.
Yeah.
I'm just kidding. Get the taser. Test the taser. Roman Greer. Just in case y'all were wondering. Roman will be next. Brother Christopher's been coming a long time. Started riding the bus, I guess, didn't you, Brother Christopher? Is that right? And it's Brother Roy's nephew. His family now, almost all their family in our church all the time now. Thank the Lord for that. He's going to come preach to you. How old are you, Christopher? 17 years old.
Amen.
Come preach.
You can turn to 1 Timothy 4.
Y'all know there's more books in the Bible than Timothy.
You stole my message.
Tell them what your message was titled that you were going to preach before this.
Don't look back. First Timothy 4:7. It says, but refuse profane and old wives' fables, and exercise thyself rather unto godliness. Up here, I'm going to be talking about exercise and about resolving to be fit for Jesus. Since New Year's is coming up, we have the thing called resolutions. It's where you know, I'm going to lose this much weight, or I'm going to add this much to it, and you fail. So I'm going to help you. I'm going to hook you up right here. I'm gonna teach you how to set this thing up.
All of you fail.
I'm gonna.
Don't even bother. Go ahead, Christopher. You're doing great.
I'm gonna relate exercise with the Christian life. So let's start with the first point. The first thing you got to do is you got to develop a routine. In the Old Testament. When something was important, you know, they had to remember something. It was, they set up a memorial. God set it up for them, and it was because keep it in your head. You know, if you're going to work out, nobody really wants to do it, but they like, you know, afterwards how you feel. You know, losing weight, gaining muscle, all that good stuff. And so, but once you write it down, you know, it's out of your head. You got it set up, and you can come back to it. And once you're developing a routine, and I'm going to relate this to spirituals, once you're going to do a plan for your Bible reading, once you're going to pray or say, I'm going to do this once a week, whatever, blah, 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 if you set up a routine and you write it down, it's a whole lot easier than just keeping it in your head, because, you know, there's so much other stuff going on in your head, and you're going to just, you know, it's not going to work out. So if you, for example, just forget that. The part C is the one thing when developing a routine is you adapt. You can't restart on a routine. If you mess up, which we all miss certain things, we all have our different things that's harder, adapt. Don't restart. And what I mean by that is just add on to what you're doing, you know, and adjust it to your schedule. For example, when it comes to our reading, you know, Brother Tony usually wants us to read the Bible at least once a year. I didn't get to finish this year, but it was because I kept reading the same Bible books over and over, because I would start a plan, and then I would get bored of it, and then you restart. You restart from Genesis. So then you go back to Genesis, and then you go again, and then you get bored, and then you go back, and you just keep doing it. You keep reading the same books. So the point is, if you adapt and you just adjust to your schedule, it's a whole lot easier. It's a whole lot easier on the brain. Secondly, the motives, who, what, when, where, why, you know, with exercising, what are you going to do, how are you going to do it, when are you going to do it, why are you doing it?
Yeah.
And the same thing in the Christian life, the most important thing is why, you know, why do you love Jesus, why do you do all this stuff, why do you fast, and, you know, stuff like that. Secondly, develop standards in moderation. You need to figure out what you can and what you cannot do. Once you establish that, it's a whole lot easier to go forward.
Yeah.
But you need to develop a balance. You know, in our Christian life, you can't fully go in, you know, forget about your family. You got to have a balance, family, Christian life, your work, stuff like that. If you don't set up standards, what you result in is a life without guardrails.
Yeah.
And then once you go off the deep end, there's nothing to stop you. You just go straight off and you go off the deep end. What happens is you just need to prepare yourself and set these things up. One analogy with a person who diets and a Christian life is they have their caloric intake. Us as Christians, we have a heart intake.
Yeah.
So Matthew 6:21 talks about where your treasure is, there where your heart be also.
Yeah.
That means what you love and what you do, you know, it'll show on you. And also Luke 6:45, the end of it says, out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaketh.
Yeah,
so we can see what you intake the most. If you intake gossip or rumors the most, you're going to be a person who talks most about that stuff. If you like movies, you know, you know those people who can, you know, quote any movie. It's all about that. And God, in the end, God will weigh your actions. 1 Samuel 2:3, at the end it says, by him actions are weighed. So, and lastly, be bold and break through plateaus. A plateau is just when you don't have any gains. You're doing the same thing, but you're just getting no gains. And this is a very crucial part, which don't freak out. You have to keep pushing through it and don't resort to things that are vanity. I'll just go ahead and skip down, but you got to break your comfort zone. And at the end, James 1:4 talks about, but let patience have her perfect work, that you may be perfect and entire, wanting nothing. The point of that is patience is the ultimate exercise, and that's what you have to focus on. Let God do what you can't, and you focus on what you can do. So, yeah.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Now listen, don't just let these are not just practices for them, all right? That's not. I talked to them in the office in there, and I said, fellas, you all have prayed, you've all asked the Lord what he would have you to say, and I said, so every one of you may have something that just one person in here needs to hear, but I should have said that to you guys before we got started. If you're not careful, it's just kind of a show, you know, it's just kind of, well, we're letting these boys kind of practice. Well, no, we're not, we're letting them preach. And they have asked God what to say, and he said some stuff right there. It'd be really good for a lot of us is that we would go into this new year with some spiritual decisions, that we want to be spiritually fit. Boy, if I could get some of you to focus on your spiritual as much as you focus on the physical, we would grow spiritually by leaps and bounds. You say, well, the truth is it's just not as important to you. Amen. Now, I wouldn't let him say that, but I can say that to you, all right? And we need to get it important. And reading that Bible and praying. And listen, there's other things than that, by the way. Amen. That witnessing is part of it.
Yes, sir.
That faithfully witnessing, going out, talking to somebody, inviting them to church. Hey, he talked about fasting. There ought to be some times throughout the year that you do some fasting for different things. And that's exercising spiritual things, being fit spiritual. So that was a good message. Don't miss what these boys are saying. I know they say some funny things. I remember a young preacher preaching one time, and he got fired up, and he was going to say, bless God, I know beyond a shadow of a doubt I'm on my way to heaven. And he got all messed up and said hell instead. He said, I know beyond a shadow of a doubt I'm on my way. If I died right now, I'd go straight to hell. And everybody, so preacher boys get fired up and they get nervous, and just like us older preachers, we say crazy stuff from time to time, but don't write off everything else they're saying, because of that, you let the Lord speak to you in this service here tonight. All right, Brother Roman, you draw a name, and then we'll sing one after Roman preaches, and we got three more of them boys after that.
You can do it before.
Let's see what we got here. Draw it out.
I'm trying.
Hand it to me. Don't you read it like he did. Praise God. Micah Blanton. All right. You're kind of glad, but sort of just got sick at your stomach, right? All right. Praise the Lord. All right. This is Roman. How old are you, Roman?
16.
This is Brother Marvin, Miss Bambi's boy. He's going to preach to you.
Hey, y'all say amen for me now and then.
It really helps. All right. I'm just
I'm a little bit nervous, more nervous than what I usually am, because usually Brother Jason tells us a little bit in advance, and he did this time, and I thought I had it all planned out and everything, and I just couldn't sleep last night, and I kept having crazy dreams about being blessed, and I woke up this morning, and I just had the song I'm Blessed on my mind. Amen. And so I felt like I probably need to switch my message, so I'm preaching on simply just blessed. I'm just going to start giving you some facts real quick while you turn to Joshua 1:5. Just to let y'all know, you're blessed no matter what. Even if you're in the worst situation possible, you're still breathing, so you're blessed. 57 times forsake is in the Bible. A majority of those 57 times, it's talking about Jesus not forsaking us. My first verse is, let's see, wrong verse. It will be Joshua 1:5, and I'm just going to look at the very last part of it right here, and it says, I will not fail thee nor forsake thee. You don't have to turn to the next one, but the next one is going to be Deuteronomy, and I'll read the whole one on this one. It says, and the Lord, he it is that doth go before thee. He will be with thee, and he will not fail thee, neither forsake thee. Fear not, neither be dismayed. One thing that is just great about God is that even when he was on the cross, it said that his father turned his back. But you know what? No matter what we do, Jesus won't forsake us, no matter how far away we walk. And lately I've had some problems. I've talked to Brother Jason and Brother Tony. I haven't had any real, real bad problems, but I just kind of quit reading my Bible a little bit. And one good thing is Brother Tony kept talking about all we like sheep have gone astray, and he was just encouraging me right before basketball practice. It kind of threw me off. He just kept talking about, no matter what, you can always come back. And the other thing I want to talk about is blessed. It says blessed is all through the Bible. It is mentioned 287 times in the whole Bible, 205 times in the Old Testament, 82 times in the New Testament. Right quick before I get done, I'm going to show you two ways to know that you're blessed for sure. Number one is pretty obvious. It's salvation. I'm going to turn to John 20:29. And I'll just go ahead and start reading it for time's sake. It says, Jesus saith unto him, Thomas, because thou hast seen me, thou hast believed. But one way that we can be blessed is, blessed are they that have not seen and yet have believed. One thing that you'll hear people say a lot is, seeing is believing. It's in movies, especially during Christmas time. It's seeing is believing, and you'll hear people say it all the time. But really, seeing is not believing. It tells you right here in the Bible, it says, blessed are they that have not seen and yet believe. My next thing is forgiveness. It's in Romans. You don't have to turn there. It's Romans 4:7. It says, saying, blessed are they whose iniquities are forgiven and whose sins are covered. Forgiveness. That's another reason we know that we are saved. One of the people that we always talk about, it's David. He was a man after God's own heart. But if you think about it, really, he did a lot of things that is way worse than what we'll ever do. We might lie and we might get away from God and we might even steal something, but we haven't killed anybody. If you kill somebody, you go to jail. We haven't committed adultery. So that's some things that David did. But what was good about David and the reason he was a man after God's own heart was because he was good at asking for forgiveness. The story in the Bible in 2 Samuel 12, it talks about Nathan. And David, this was after David committed sin with Bathsheba. It says that that Nathan went up to David and he was telling the story. And there was a poor man that only had one sheep and a rich man that had many cattle and many sheep. And the rich man stole from the poor man, took his only sheep and killed it for a party. And when Nathan was telling this, David got mad and he said, tell me where this man is, and I will restore his sheep fourfold. And then what Nathan says, it's kind of crazy if you think about it. He looks and he points his finger at David's face and he says, thou art the man. Brother Jason talks about it all the time. And right then in the Bible, it talks about in verse 13, it says that David, he asked for forgiveness. He told Nathan, first of all, that he said, yeah, I have sinned. That's one thing. And then he asked for forgiveness from Jesus. So one thing that I want to say in closing is that Before you go to complain, especially, we just got done with Christmas, and I'm sure all of y'all have got plenty of gifts. My mom always says she's ridiculous. I don't know how she does it. She a lot of times says, you're only going to get a couple gifts this year. Well, one thing that's always crazy is that we'll go to bed, and they always wrap them on Christmas Eve. And we go to bed, and there's nothing under the Christmas tree. We wake up, and most of the time we have a fake tree, and they have to take branches off the bottom part of the tree just so they can fit all the presents underneath there. And this year she was like, I'm being serious this year. We're not going to have a whole lot of money to have presents, which was fine with me. I mean, it didn't really matter. And I woke up on Christmas, and it was just like every other Christmas. I just got a massive amount of gifts that I just didn't deserve. So before you go complaining, just remember that you are blessed. Yeah. You're saved, and amen. You can be forgiven.
Amen. It's good. Amen. All right. Let's all stand, turn to 356. You can come on up. You can have a seat in my chair right there, bud. 356, revive us again. We'll just sing it a cappella, Miss Scott. We praise thee, O God, for the Son of thy love. Rear back and sing it out a couple of verses, and we've got, I think, three more preachers. Is that right, Brother Jason? Three more. All right. We praise thee, O God. We praise thee, O God, for the Son of thy love. For Jesus who died and is now gone above. Hallelujah, thine the glory. Hallelujah, amen. Hallelujah, thine the glory. Revive us again. On the last verse, revive us again. Revive us again. Fill each heart. Fill each heart with thy love. May each soul be rekindled with fire from above. Hallelujah, thine the glory. Hallelujah, amen. Hallelujah, thine the glory. Revive us again. You can be seated. Brother Micah, you come draw the next name. There's only a couple left. Let's see who's going next. All right, let's see what you got there, bud. Next will be Brandon Browning. And then who's that leave for last? Brother Peyton will be last then, all right? And so this is Micah Blanton. How old are you, Micah?
14.
14. How many times have you preached?
One.
This is the second time. And Brother Mike and his family, raise your hand, Brother Mike. They're sitting right there. They've been coming for a good while now. He's going to preach to you. You help him out now. Preach, brother.
Good evening again. Acts 9, please. I'll read a few verses. I actually have a lot, but I'm going to not read all of them for the sake of time. So, And Saul, yet breathing out threatenings and slaughter against the disciples of the Lord, went unto the high priest, and desired of him letters to Damascus, to the synagogues, that if he found any of this way, whether they were men or women, he might bring them bound unto Jerusalem. And as he journeyed, he came near Damascus, and suddenly there shined round about him a light from heaven. And he fell to the earth, and heard a voice saying unto him, Saul, Saul, why persecutest thou me? And he said, Who art thou, Lord? And the Lord said, I am Jesus, whom thou persecutest. It is hard for thee to kick against the pricks. And he, trembling and astonished, said, Lord, what wilt thou have me to do? And the Lord said unto him, Arise and go to the city. It shall be told thee what thou must do. So the title that I have here is How to Give It All Like Paul. We see in verse 1 and verse 2 that Saul was a sinner like us.
Yes.
We saw that he is a Roman and he persecuted Christians. He was technically, if you want to say it, a modern-day terrorist.
Yeah.
But we see later on that even the vilest sinner can be saved.
Yeah,
and that,
yes, sir. Praise the Lord.
I was thinking earlier, what if there was just a big revival in the Middle East?
Yeah.
That would do wonders.
Yes, sir.
So, and then we see in verses 3, 4, all the way through 9, that he met a Savior named Jesus.
Yeah.
In verse 3, he was blinded by the light. And I was thinking earlier, I wonder why Jesus chose to blind him. And then I was thinking, he probably done it because Jesus is the light of the world.
Yeah.
And then after he was blinded, his life changed for the good.
Yeah. Amen.
His faith changed. Even his name changed later on.
Yeah.
And then he did what we are called to do. If you jump to verse 20, he says, "And straightway he preached Christ in the synagogues, that he is the Son of God." And 21, "But all that heard him were amazed and said, Is not this he that destroyed them which called on this name in Jerusalem, and came hither for that intent, that he might bring them bound unto the chief priest?" So they were wondering why even this guy who was persecuting Christians every day would be saved, and now it's preaching what he just, you know, tried to get rid of.
That's right.
And then they saw that since he could be saved, there really is a God.
Yeah. Amen.
And then if you jump over a couple chapters to chapter 16, we see that he stood through persecution for the faith.
Yes, sir.
We see that he was whipped and beat, and then he was even thrown in prison. So we have to stand through persecution, even because he was the one that was doing the persecution before.
Yeah.
But now he kind of got a taste of his own medicine.
Yeah.
And then he ended up preaching the gospel to everybody, and then he witnessed to the world.
Good job. Good preaching.
Amen. We need to give it all like Paul. That's good preaching. This is Brother Brandon. How old are you, Brandon? 17 years old. No need to draw the name. We know Brother Peyton is next, so you come on and preach for us.
Amen. If you would, please tonight turn your Bibles to John chapter 3. Given the Christmas season, I decided to go ahead and stick with it, even though it is right after Christmas. But it's all fresh in our hearts, so I figured I would go ahead and preach something along those lines. Of course, Christmas is the time of the year that we celebrate Christ's birth. Well, that was over 2,000 years ago. And I was wondering why exactly did Jesus come, and it's to live a sinless life, and he died and rose again 3 days so that you and I may have eternal life with him in heaven one day. I didn't really understand it a whole lot, and I don't really understand it, but why he would do that. So I asked myself a question: why would he sacrifice himself so that, because we can offer nothing in return, there's nothing that we can do for Jesus. There was no gain on his part by sacrificing himself. It's really just because he loves us. Like when a father loves his child so much that he gives everything to, given everything for him, it's a powerful love. Well, in John 3:16, it said, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life." The reason that Jesus Christ came is because God loved us and he wanted to see us in heaven.
Amen.
Jesus' love is the greatest love. In John 15:13, the Bible says, "Greater love hath no man than this, that a man lay down his life for his friends." There is no match for Jesus' love he had for us. He absolutely gave everything. There was no reason for him to come for 33 years besides for us, and he only did that because he loved us. And it's also the closest love. In Proverbs 18:24, it says, "There is a friend that sticketh closer than a brother." Well, I've had three brothers, and one of them is my younger brother, so I've known him my whole life, and I grew up with him. We spent our entire lives together, so we know everything about each other.
Yeah.
But Jesus Christ, he knows even more about me. He knows he's closer to me, and he loves me more than my brother ever will. I don't know how you could love any more than my brother, because I love my brother a lot, and I don't understand how that he can love us enough to where he'd even just die for us. Lastly, it's the longest love. In Jeremiah 31:3, it says, "I have loved thee with an everlasting love."
Yeah. Amen.
Jesus Christ will love us. He loved us yesterday, he loves us today, and he'll love us forever in eternity.
Amen.
And just Jesus came because he loves us.
It's good, Brandon.
Amen.
Smile, boys, while you're doing this. I mean, you're giving them the best news they ever heard, but you look like you're sad about it, so smile every now and then. Praise God. All right, this is Brother Peyton. I think we got some girl. Who's supposed to sing? I think we got some young ladies supposed to sing. Y'all go ahead and get ready. Come get your microphones. Here, I tell you what, Roman, come grab them microphones, make sure they're on. Who's playing for you? All right, y'all go ahead and get in place. As soon as Peyton finishes, y'all go ahead and sing. And then I need about 5 minutes right at the end. I want to tell you what our theme is going to be for 2016. So Brother Peyton will come and preach, and then these girls will sing, and then I'll give you the theme, and then we'll go. All right? How old are you, Peyton?
15. 16. I just turned 16.
All right. Come on. I'm just going to let you off the hook. I mean, You opened yourself up for me to tear you up there, but I'm going to let you slide. Praise God.
Turn your Bibles, if you would, to Luke chapter 16. Luke chapter 16. This is a passage of Scripture that most of you, I'm sure, probably know pretty well. And so for that reason, I'm not going to read all of it or anything like that. I'm just going to get right to the meat of it. Luke chapter 16 is the story of the rich man and a beggar named Lazarus. It's a story that Jesus tells. It says, "And it came to pass that the beggar died and was carried by the angels into Abraham's bosom. And the rich man also died and was buried. And in hell he lift up his eyes, being in torments, and seeth Abraham afar off, and Lazarus in his bosom. And he cried and said, Father Abraham, have mercy on me, and send Lazarus that may dip the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue, for I am tormented in this flame. But Abraham said, Son, remember that thou in thy lifetime receivest thy good things, and likewise Lazarus evil things. But now he is comforted, and thou art tormented. And beside all this, there is between us and thee a great gulf fixed, so that they which would pass to us from you cannot, neither can they pass to us that would come from thence." Revelations 20:12 says, "And I saw the dead, small and great, stand before God. And the books were opened, and another book was opened, which is the book of life. And the dead were judged out of the things which were written in the books according to their works. And the and the sea gave up the dead which were in it, and death and hell delivered up the dead which were in them. And they were judged every man according to their works. And death and hell were cast into the lake of fire, which is the second death. And all those who were not found written in the book of life were thrown into the lake, cast into the lake of fire." Revelation 21:8 says, "But the fearful and unbelieving and the abominable and whoremongers and sorcerers and idolaters and all liars shall have their part in the lake which burneth with fire and brimstone, which is the second death." Now, hell is a real place, and it is not a figment of someone's imagination or a state of mind or an experience on earth. It's a reality, and it's a tormenting place, a terrible place that I would wish that no one would have to go to. Yeah. But because some reject Christ, and because some even do not know the story as we know of Jesus Christ and what he did for us and how he took on our sins, some are headed to that place right now.
Come on.
But most of us in here, we're a Sunday night crowd, and we know the story quite well. 2 Samuel 14:14 says, "We are as water spilt out on the ground, which cannot be gathered up again, neither doth God respect any persons, yet doth he devise means whereby his banished be not expelled from him." We know this truth, and we know that Jesus died for our sins according to the Scriptures, and he was raised on the third day and has saved us from hell if we have prayed and trusted him. Romans 5:6 says, "When we were yet without strength, in due time Christ died for the ungodly.
Yes,
for scarcely for a righteous man would one die. Yet peradventure for a good man some would even dare to die. But God commendeth his love toward us, in that while we were yet sinners,
Amen.
Christ died for us."
Yeah.
1 John 4:10 says, "Herein is love, not that we loved God, but that he loved us, and gave his Son to be the propitiation for our sins." I want you to observe for a moment the reality of hell. I want you to observe the reality of the unquenchable fire. Matthew 3:12 says, "Whose fan is in his hand, and he will thoroughly purge his floor, and will gather the wheat into the garner, but will burn up the chaff with unquenchable fire." Hell is a place that is characterized by the fire that is in it. It is a place where there is constant burning, constant pain, constant sorrow because of the flames which are constantly consuming the souls that are trapped there. You know, if someone had to lay down in fire for one day, they would know at the end of that one day they would go free from that pain, and they would not have to know that any longer. They would be completely freed of that. If they knew that if they lay down for a week in the fire, they would know that at the end of the week they would be free from that fire. For a year, they would know that at the end of that year they would be free from that fire. But in hell, there is no assurance of redemption from that pain.
Yeah, that's right.
You're stuck with it at that point. The soul that is sent there is stuck there because there is the reality of unending death, where their worm dieth not and the fire is not quenched.
Yeah.
There is no hope of eventual relief. It is just constant pain. And also realize the reality of unbearable separation. Separation from the grace of God and from his mercy and love, which is a terrible thing that I would not wish on my worst enemy. But sadly, there are those who even we have not shared the gospel with who are going there. And I want you to realize the reality of hell and what a terrible place it is. And keep it in your mind as you go through your life that you might live more purely so that you could more powerfully witness to people. Yeah. And that you would have a greater passion to witness to people and tell people about this terrible place, but more importantly of the Savior who loved them enough yeah. to save them from Amen. It. And the hope that he has given you, has given all of us. And I would hope that if you have not accepted the free gift of salvation yeah. from this terrible place, that you would accept Jesus Christ and know his love for you. He wants to be your best friend. He wants to walk closely with you. He wants to be your Lord and Savior. Just accept his salvation.
Just go ahead and start playing. Let's just bow our heads here right before these girls sing. I'm going to tell you, that was a great message to finish on. Every bit of the thoughts that were given tonight, all of our growth as a Christian, all of our learning as a Christian, all of our trying to live right as a Christian, all of that ultimately comes down to the fact that there is a hell, and that we that are saved never have to go there, but that there are people who have never heard, and people that have heard but have never received, that we need to try to reach with the gospel. What a great challenge to finish the night. Now again, I've got a little thought for you for our theme, and it'll be a blessing that Peyton ended on that. I praise the Lord for the number of verses he quoted in that message there. You can see he's worked on that. And he's done that not for show. He's done that because he's concerned about hell and others going there. Would you pray and ask the Lord to help you have a burden? Let's ask him to give our church a burden. Father, I thank you for these boys. I thank you that they love you, and Lord, they try to live for you. We watch them regularly. We watch them daily. And I know if we were to get their parents up here, I'm sure they could tell us about faults and failures just like we all have. But Lord, for the most part, these young men have given their lives to try to live for you and serve you. And I know for every one of them, we have a young lady that's also trying to do the same. And we praise you for them as well. And we just thank you, Lord, that in our church you have blessed us with a great number of young people who have the desire to live for you and serve you. Lord, I pray that tonight we as the adults will be challenged, that we would go through this year with a fresh desire and a fresh zeal to try to live in front of them, that we would be the examples for these young people. Lord, they should not be leading us, we should be leading them in all areas of spiritual growth and spirituality. And I pray that you'd help us with our verse memorization. Help us with our witnessing and inviting folks to church. Help us with our singing and preaching and teaching and all the things that we do, that we would lead the way for these young people, that they could go with us. Then one of these days when we're off the scene, they could continue to go beyond us. We pray that you'd help us to have a burden for these things that have been shared with us. We praise you for them. Encourage these young men, Lord, the good job that they've done. Bless the girls as they sing in the finish of our service here in a few minutes. We'll praise you for it in Jesus' name. Amen. If you listen to them, then you give me about 5 minutes and then we'll be done tonight.
There are things in every journey that can break us. There are burdens that can bring us to our knees. But it's in those moments when our faith feels weakest that we simply stand our ground and just believe. Pray now, right here in the storm, he's still the same. Pray now, pray now, there is strength and power in Jesus' name. So pray now. Oh, the silence doesn't mean that he's not listening. And the darkness doesn't mean that he is gone. For he promised he would never, ever leave us. And you never spent one moment on your own. So pray now. Pray now, right here in the storm, he's still the same. Pray now, pray now, there is strength and power in Jesus' name, so pray now. anything too hard for God. Who's gonna prove that beyond his power to solve? Other situations he's not the master of. Is anything too hard for God? The same. Pray now, pray now. There is strength and power in Jesus' name. There is strength and power in Jesus' name. So pray now, pray.
Brother Justin, will you get them lights for me right there? There's an unspoken request right now. There's a family in our church going through something that we're not ready yet to tell everybody about. So if you'd bow with me, just with that song being sung, pray now. Let's just pray right now. If you would, now I know I'm going to pray, but I want you to pray for the unspoken so I could pray better if I knew what it was. Probably not. God knows. All right. So just pray passionately. They'll find something out tomorrow. And so I want you to pray with me, and then I'll give you those 5 minutes. Father, I'm thankful, Lord, for that song. I'm thankful that we can pray. And I'm thankful that we can pray instantly and immediately, and that you hear us. And Lord, we trust and ask you right now that you'd be merciful in this situation. Lord, as I said earlier to the family, Lord, we don't deserve you to do anything for us, but we so trust in the mercies of God that are everlasting. And Lord, you long to be merciful, and Lord, you look for opportunities to be merciful. And we pray right now that you'd be merciful to this family, that you would give a good report tomorrow, Lord, as they go and talk to some people and try to figure some things out. We pray that you would guide and direct, that you'd give a positive report. Lord, we'd love to shout about it on Wednesday night and give you the glory for it. We pray that you'd bless them now in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, all right, you can bring the lights down just a little bit if you would. Let me go ahead and put the picture up for the theme for 2016. And the theme is sowing the seed. It comes from the end of the verse there in 2 Corinthians 9, verse 6, where it says, he which soweth bountifully shall reap also bountifully. Let me say three things. Number one, the emphasis for this theme is tracts. Gospel tracts. That's going to be our emphasis. You said we talk about it a lot. Yeah, but we're going to really hit it in 2016. The idea of sowing here is, the seed is the word of God. In that parable of the sower, where Jesus said a sower went forth to sow, and then he said some fell on stony ground and all those other things happened to it. He said the seed is the word of God. And aren't you glad we've got the perfect, pure, powerful word of God in the King James Bible? Say amen right there. And our tracts all have scriptures from the King James Bible in them. So the emphasis is going to be on tracts. Now, the effort is to sow bountifully. Sow bountifully. If you'll notice, when a man goes to sow seeds, he don't just sow one or two. He sows bountifully. His hand is full, and if you know how this works, he'll throw that handful out, and he'll grab another handful and throw it out, and grab another handful and throw it out. And the idea is, he that soweth bountifully shall also reap bountifully. And we're going to set a big numerical goal. I don't have that. I'm going to try and figure it out this week what I want to do and pray about it, and I'll probably preach on the theme next Sunday morning or night, I'm not sure which, but we'll have a large numerical goal for the year, and we're going to have ways that we can track what we've done, and we're excited about trying to. You say, we're going to set a big goal so we can tell anybody? No, not so we can tell anybody. We're going to set a goal to motivate ourselves. That's what the goal is for. It's not to brag to anybody that we've given out more tracts than some other church. It's simply to motivate us to give out more than we've ever given out before. We believe that Jesus is coming and that he's coming soon. And then he may come right in the middle of 2016. Wouldn't it be great if when he comes, we're doing more than we've ever done before to see people saved? That'd be a good way to get caught by Jesus, wouldn't it? And so the effort is to sow bountifully. We're gonna try to keep track of what we've done individually and as a church. And I thought about this. I want to see how many different states our church can give a track out in. Now, I know we've got missionaries and all that, but I'm talking about our church. I'll travel some. I know some of you travel for your jobs. Brother Wayne will be traveling some on deputation. Brother Arnold will be traveling some, and different ones will be traveling for vacation. And I'd like to see how many states our church can physically, somebody from our church can give a gospel tract out in this year. Acts 1:8, I've told it to you many times, has got them four areas in the world that we as an individual church are responsible to try and reach with the gospel. Not just Marion. We're going to do that. We do it a lot. Hey, but also the state of North Carolina, also the United States of America, and then, of course, even foreign countries. If all goes according to the calendar, I'll be in a couple, or at least one foreign country, maybe two foreign countries this year, and some of you also in your travels will be in foreign countries. We want to give the gospel out everywhere we go and try to sow bountifully. I'm also going to have weekly specific goals for you. Challenge you every week to give a specific goal. For example, we might say 1 week the goal is for everybody to give a tract to a coworker and push you to give that tract specifically to somebody. 1 week it might be to a law officer. You know what you ought to do? You ought to give a tract to a law officer and then tell them that you pray for them. By the way, don't tell them you pray for them if you don't pray for them. So I guess we ought to back up first and say you ought to pray for them. Then you ought to give them a gospel tract and tell them Jesus loves them and tell them, hey, I thank you. Thank you for your service and I pray for you. I gave one in Kentucky the other day on the way home, found one at a gas station, and I just spoke to him and said, hey, thank you for your service. And I gave him a gospel tract. I appreciate them looking out for us, don't you? Hey, listen, a lot of the world right now are giving them a hard time. We ought to be thankful for them. They're out there tonight so that we can be in here tonight fear-free, praise the Lord. We ought to be thankful for them, and you ought to respect them, and you ought to pray for them, and let's give a tract to them as well. So things like that, give a tract to a neighbor at their home. It's one thing to see them out. It's another thing to go to their house. Brother Matt preached about this not long ago, that he was burdened and convicted, and he was getting ready to go all the way to Wales and give out tracts door to door, and he had not witnessed to the neighbor at the end of our road. And so the Lord dealt with him. He went to his door, he knocked on the door and told him just that. And so little specific challenges each week. As you're giving out tons of tracts, we'll have a specific challenge each week to try to do. So the emphasis is tracts, the effort so bountifully, the expectation is that we might reap bountifully. Yeah, man, that's the whole point. The whole point is that we be faithful in our part, and we know God will be faithful in His part. And we might not necessarily see a bunch of people get saved that we gave a tract to, but here's what I believe God can do. God can see our faithfulness over here and bring forth reaping over here. He don't have to reap it in the same field we sowed it. He can reap just our effort. And so we want to sow bountifully in the hopes that we might reap bountifully. And the first is, I believe, on Friday. Is that right? January the 1st is on Friday? Shake your head if that's right. I don't even know. Something like that. Say amen. That's close enough. These preacher boys don't know, do you, fellas? One of them don't even know how old he is, praise God. And so you can start this week. We've got just a few of our question mark 100% sure tracks right here. There's a whole wall of Fellowship Track League tracks back there. We support that ministry and financially, and then we have some of their tracks. I want to challenge you to start this week. When it gets here, hey, you should start before then, but at the very least, commit in your heart that you are going to emphasize the giving out of gospel tracks in your life in 2016, and you can start doing that on Monday. If somebody's going to be traveling this week, go ahead and grab some tracks and take them with you and keep a record, all right? And let's see what we can do. I believe that God will do His part if we'll be faithful to do our part. And I know that we've got, look at me, I know we got a few people that are real good at this. All right? Brother Marvin's mom, Miss Lydia, I don't know where she's sitting. She's sitting right there. She's real good at this. Now, Miss Lydia's got a very rich accent. I don't know if you've spoken to her. I don't even know where it's from, but it ain't Kentucky. I guarantee you that. She don't sound like me and Brother Samuel, praise God. But I'll tell you what she does do. She gives out the gospel tracts like candy, man. She gives them at her where she goes. I know we've got some people that are good at it, but I also know, look here, hey, I also know we got a whole bunch of us that are not. All right? And there is a judgment seat of Christ coming. And you're going to want to be good at it at the judgment seat of Christ. I'm not just trying to help myself here. This is not just build the church. This is to build your judgment seat of Christ. This is commanded of us that we might sow bountifully. So I want you to be challenged in the giving of tracts. We're going to talk to you about it. We're going to preach about it. We're going to do it in Sunday school. We're going to pass it on to the bus kids. We're going to do it in every ministry. And we're going to see what the Lord will do as we try to be faithful in one of these commands that He has given us. All right? It's been a good day in church. Amen? Let's pray and we'll be dismissed. Heavenly Father, we thank You.